Good evening, everybody. Thank you for joining us this evening for our Good Friday service. This is called a tenebrae service. Tenebrae is Latin and it means a service of shadows. And it's been a service that has been practiced since medieval times. Originally, it was used by monks in a monastery, and then it was developed by other Christian traditions, and we join with other Christians tonight, and even throughout the world, using the tenebrae format. And what it will involve will be some music at the beginning, and a thought for myself, and then we move to the tenebrae itself, which is just a number of readings, and after each reading, a candle here will be extinguished until they're all gone, and one will return at the end. And when that returns at the end, that signals that the service is over. So gather around if you want to have your Bible handy. Most of the readings will be coming from Matthew 26 and 27. And if you'd just rather listen, that's perfectly fine. But above all, we're delighted that you're here. Just a reminder that on Sunday, we hope, God willing, at 10:30 to have our Easter celebration, and all are welcome. And as ever, I'm so glad that Brian's here to help with the service. In his music ministry, but also in sharing the readings. Thank you, Ryan, for being here. So we're here to worship, and we're here to worship the living Lord. Thought we'd begin by singing When I Survey the Wondrous Cross to a more modern tune, but hopefully in our memories, if we have got hymn books, we will recall in mind the words. So When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Thank you.
please forgive us all our sins. We acknowledge we are not worthy, but we praise you, you made it all possible. Hallelujah. So help us, Spirit of God, to recall tonight the wonder of this night. Humble us all in the presence of the living Lord. We pray we would never take for granted ever again the extent of the love that Jesus has for every one of us. And may that love overwhelm us afresh this evening. We pray our prayer in the name of Jesus. And together we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, we'll be hearing the scripture read for us in a few moments, but just a thought for this evening, and can I be honest with you and say I've always struggled to preach on Good Friday, because I think sometimes there are no words to express how I would feel personally, and I know probably how many of you feel when we do think of the extent of the love of Jesus for us. And yet we have to find some words. It's interesting, at Christmas time we sing O Holy Night, and maybe we should sing that on Good Friday, because this is the very heart of our faith. I was reading during the week that you cannot get to Sunday except through Friday. And it's thinking about Good Friday and Easter Sunday. You cannot get to Sunday except through Friday. And let's not rush to celebrate Jesus coming alive, but let's use the time to reflect and to contemplate the suffering Savior who suffered because he loves us so much. And in my devotions this week, there was a little ready-made sermon, so I have stolen it, and I'm going to share it with us this evening. And first of all, nothing definitive has been discovered yet, but they'll keep on going as money is available and the world wants to make money available so that it can return to life as we need it. And we must never forget tonight how much it cost Jesus to go to that cross, walking that lonely road. And when we think that in the scripture, a lamb often was sacrificed to help the person get right with God. And tonight we're reminded that the spotless Lamb of God has gone to Calvary to die in our place for us. And that is costly love. The hymn writer says, we may not know, we cannot tell what pains he had to bear, but we believe it was for us he hung and suffered there. So sin is a curse, and the remedy of it cost our Heavenly Father his only Son, who died on that green hill, far away, outside a city wall, for you and for me. And in doing that, we find forgiveness, we find new life, we find a fresh start. It's wonderful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah for Jesus. And finally, it is in Jesus and in opening our life to him, thinking about the cost of it all, that it's in Jesus there is a cure for the sin sick soul. I was reading that Sir Alexander Fleming in St. Mary's Hospital, London, was experimenting with the influenza virus in his lab. And in 1928, in experimenting, he accidentally discovered penicillin. He was regarded as a bit of a slap hazard technician. But nevertheless, his discovery saved lives and is still saving lives today. One can hardly believe a world without penicillin, without antibiotics. His discovery was life-changing. And tonight is about the fact that when we discover Jesus for ourselves, it's life-changing. There's the cure for all of them. He reaches out to us from the cross and says, I love you and I am putting all this for you. I beg us to respond. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. I'm going to conclude now, but I want to quote a verse from a Wesley hymn. Then let us stand beneath the cross and feel his love a healing spring. All things for him account of loss and give up all our hearts to him. Of nothing think or speak beside. My Lord, my love, is crucified. Thank God, his only Son went the extra mile for us. Let's embrace him and go the extra mile for him. Amen. We're going to sing, Oh, to see the dawn. Thank you. first reading, the shadow of betrayal. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me." They were very sad and began to say to him one after the other, "Surely not I, Lord." Jesus replied, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to the man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." Jesus answered, "Yes, it is you."
The shadow of the agony of spirit and arrest. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found him sleeping, because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd, armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them: "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him." Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Do what you came for, friend." Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him.
The shadow of denial. Now Peter was sitting out in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him. "You also were with Jesus of Galilee," she said. But he denied it before them all. "I don't know what you're talking about," he said. Then he went out to the gateway where another girl saw him and said to the people there, "This fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth." He denied it again with an oath, "I don't know the man." After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, "Surely you are the one of them, for your accent gives you away." Then he began to call down curses on himself, and he swore to them, "I don't know the man." Immediately, a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered the words Jesus had spoken, "Before the cock crows, you will disown me 3 times. And he went outside and wept bitterly.
The shadow of accusation. Meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. But he was accused by the chief priests and the elders. He gave no answer. Then Pilate asked him, "Don't you hear the testimony they are bringing against you?" But Jesus made no reply, not even to a single charge, to the great amazement of the governor. But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas, and to have Jesus executed. "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" Pilate asked. They all answered, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him!" When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility is on us and on our children. Then he released Barabbas to them. But he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff on his right hand. Then they knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said. They spat on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away.
The shadow of crucifixion and humiliation. As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him then. After and above his head, they placed the written charge against him. "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two robbers were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults on him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself, come down from the cross, if you are the Son of God." In the same way, chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him, for he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" The same way the robbers who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him.
The shadow of death. From noon until 3 PM, darkness came over all the land. About 3 PM, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" when some of those standing there heard this, they said, "He's calling Elijah." Immediately one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with fine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him." And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs ripped open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God."
The shadow of burial. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene